We have been having a delightful session since yesterday morning, and that would continue, this can I can assure you. Now, without wasting much time, the first speaker would be, this is a session on innovations in rural revitalization. And for this, we have very distinguished speakers. One is Anshu Gupta. And Anshu is not new to XLRI now. Let me read something about Anshu. Anshu Gupta, an Ashoka Fellow and Ashoka Global Ambassador, founded GOONJ in 1998, an organization which collects, recycles and distributes about 80,000 kg of clothes every month. Those of you who are strong in arithmetics, 80,000 kg would be how many tons? No idea. 80. Under every month to the needy across 20 states. The clothes are distributed through grassroots NGOs under the Clothes for Work scheme, which has helped creating many crores worth of rural infrastructure. Anshu Gupta is an alumnus of Indian Institute of Mass Communication and Masters in Economics. For his work, he has been the recipient of the Chainmakers Innovation Award 2004-2006, World Bank's Development Marketplace Award 2007, and NGO of the Year Award 2007. So here is a celebrity for you. The second speaker would be Prakash Michael. And third, as I promised to him, it will be Pradeep Ghosh. I'll be introducing them when their turn comes. So over to Anshu at this point of time.
Good afternoon. Maybe some of the people, at least say one third of the people, will have to close their ears for next 5 minutes, because I will be actually playing the same tape which I must have played about 1,000 times. But in the interest of new people, I will just share that and then come back to this. With a very basic focus today is on how very, very small looking issues are very big issues for rural India. That is one part. And how very, very small looking, mundane kind of solutions can actually bring a major change in rural India. I think, to be honest, that is what my, ultimately the takeaway has to be that for me. And this is what I want to convey. But before that, because the people who do not know what we do, and why we do, and how we do, basically, it's all about clothing. Although when we talk about 80 to 100 tons of material, it is not clothing. It is like cloth, utensil, footwear, to doors, windows, anything and everything we recycle, we reuse. But the entry point has been cloth on a very basic parameter, because we a few years back argued that three basic needs you talk about, you say food, cloth and shelter, roti, kapda or makan. And then you ignore kapda, cloth. So cloth, you remember when a disaster happens, so you need earthquake in Kashmir or flood in Bihar or in Odisha. Then you suddenly remember that people need clothes. So what we argued a few years back, that half the world does not need a disaster. So why do a village needs a disaster first and then the clothes come? Also, if you call earthquake a disaster, flood a disaster, why don't you call winters a disaster? This year, even in south, in Belgaum, the temperature went down to 7.2. So people now realize what is cold all about. But you need to understand that in this country, more people die in winters than earthquake or flood. And it is not a predictable disaster, it's a known disaster. It has to come at a particular time for a particular community. Earthquake happens, everybody is worried, you know, that people are dying of cold. But does the earthquake really matter for the homeless people? Your own capital has about 1.5 lakh homeless people. You know? And we also need to understand that maybe in earthquake, shake kills people, in flood or now tsunami, the force of water kills people. In winters, the cold does not kill people, because if the cold kills people, even I would have died. I am standing in front of you and a whole lot of people died on the road. It's not the winters, but the lack of clothing which killed them. So we started with 67 clothes in 98 informally, and today, as you know, we deal with about 1800 tons. Just two things before I start. One is the story of Habib, which I must have repeated again and again, but just to again, you know, I am also a part of communication line, and I know that the message has to go again and again, then only people understand this. Habib is a person who used to pick up dead bodies from the roads of Old Delhi. I met him about 20 years back in my journalism days. Very strange profession that he will pick up unclaimed abundant dead bodies of the migrant people who come in search of a job, and then due to various reasons, right from cold to hunger to drugs to accidents, they die. These are the people who come from the states where we are trying to talk about the rural innovation. And then this person, Habib, the police, the children will inform Habib. Habib will go pick up the dead body with his blind wife, Amna Begum, dump it. Between two bed termination, they will terminate that person whose relatives are still looking for that person. He was paid 20 rupees and 2 meter of white cloth, 1991. Two statements which became the headline of a magazine when I wrote. One, when Habib bhai said ki jaadon mein mera dhanda badh jata hai, kabhi kabhi itna kaam hota hai ki samajhta nahi. So in winters my work goes up and he cannot handle it. That's what he claimed, and the work was to pick up unclaimed dead bodies from the roads of Delhi police just within the range of 3 to 4 kilometers. For my utter surprise, he used to pick up 10 to 12 dead bodies every 24 hours. In winters, summers used to be 3 to 4. 7 to 8 additional deaths, not because of winter, but because of lack of clothing. His little daughter, 5.5-6 years old, Kanish Banu, who is not there now, who died. But in those days, she gave a very shocking statement by saying ki jab mujhe thand lagti hai to main lash ke saath chipak kar so jati hu. Lash tang nahi karti, lash karvat nahi badalti. When I feel cold, I hug the dead body and sleep. It does not trouble me, it does not turn around. Now you just try to understand that if this is the condition in your capital outside a hospital with a footfall of 5,000, 6,000 people, what is the condition of rural or the remote parts of the country? That was one thought. On the basis of many, many such stories, this work has started. One more issue of the sanitary napkin, which I will be talking, because that is the issue which we touched upon in 2004, and now it has become a government policy. And another scam is coming, in making of 2,000 crore rupees, where the government wants to distribute free or highly subsidized napkin, and they want to buy it from market forces, which is a very debatable issue. But in 2004, if you type sanitary napkin or sanitary pad on Google, you find the biggest and the fanciest cups and tampons from US and UK. You will not find even a single major research, major project from India. This is a country where the focus of development is women. When you talk about microfinance, when you talk about self-help group, when you talk about any health issue, the target is women. You will never find sanitary pads as a subject. And what, because we were working on the issue of clothing, for us it was important to understand that if a woman does not have cloth to wear or to cover herself, from where and how she brings a piece of cloth. And when the Google didn't support us, just because there was no information on that, because there was no work there, we started traveling in the country, and what we found was absolutely shocking. Right from they using dirtiest piece of cloth, they wash it, they cannot dry it in sunlight. Washing itself is a problem which needs solution in rural India especially. Because now, as the water bodies are drying up, total dependency for water in rural India and slum India is on hand pumps. Hand pumps in the name of public convenience are always put up at a public place. So you do not even have privacy to take bath. You cannot imagine washing a piece of cloth. So with moisture they are wearing it again. In slums they dry it behind the doors, and in the evening before the man folk comes, they pick it up, dump it in a corner. With moisture and dust they wear it. Then we found if you have 2 to 3 women in the family, their cycles are different, they are sharing the same piece of cloth. We further found that not only in the family, this is also shared with the neighbors. So in many areas it is basically a cluster's property. Whenever anybody wants, they use it. Sundarban, if you go today, And look at the thing, you know, even your old handkerchief is a solution. But if you go to Sundarban today, you will find, you will meet women who are using the same piece of cloth for over a year. It has become a stone. But because there is no excess of a small piece of cloth as a sanitary pad. Millions of women, not only in India, in Asia, in Africa, are actually using things like sand, ash, jute gani ware, dari ka tukda, mitti, ghas, puwal, bori ka tukda, yahan tak ki polythene. So anything which they think can absorb or stop is used as a sanitary pad. What is the benefit of any kind of health intervention in the villages if the basic is not taken care of? When you have cases of women who, you know, who just use a piece of blouse and died of tetanus, or in Tamil Nadu a centipede entered through the body, the lady died. When you find that the removal of uterus, the major reason is lack of a piece of cloth as sanitary pad, because the moment an infection happens to the village women, they are told that now there are chances of cervical cancer, it's better to remove uterus. Even in, you know, with World Bank, when we won this award in 2007, we went and they started talking all about what you must have been hearing, especially in the management, of measurability, sustainability, impact, assessment and all those. We asked the last question, we said that you are the biggest funders in the health segment. How many health projects have you ever funded which had a separate budget for sanitary pad? How many health projects have you ever seen which even had a small paragraph for sanitary pad? And the guys didn't have an answer. The only answer was hardly any. Now you tell me that, do you really need any kind of quantitative, qualitative analysis? Or it's a bit of common sense that if you really solve the problem of sanitary pad, half the women health related issues will not even come up. So that's what I'm saying. The small looking issues, hidden issues, are the major problem of rural India. So we just started working on that one. What I'm going to show you in just a series of photographs is that one thing which has been a part of charity across the globe, which has never been a subject. So like we always say that from domestic violence to global warming, you will find 100-150 issues, but clothing you will not even find listed as issues. So it's a highly charitable thing, and it always happens on the basis of what you have, not what people need, if you talk about the so-called donation of cloth. So we said that it has to move away from donation, it has to become a resource for the development. Why? Because when you talk to urban India, or now any other countries, wherever now the model is trying to go, whenever you say that I want to donate cloth, that is actually a wrong and overstatement, because the fact remains that you never donate, you actually discard. So be a developed nation, your Levi's jeans will be there in the landfill site. So let us honor the person who is using our second-hand used cloth, because that person has extended the life cycle of something on which we spent so much of our hard and money. So out here it has to change. In rural India, why don't we understand that the biggest asset of village people is something called self-respect? Why don't we understand that the dignity is the biggest issue with rural India? How many beggars have you ever seen in village India? Please understand that begging is a typical city phenomena. Beggars are not found in the villages. No initiative by corporate, by institution, by NGOs, by government should be there which challenges the dignity of people. Because we all live for dignity. We all die for dignity. So why do we have this double standard that we want to live and we want them to survive at any cost? Why can't they also live a dignified life? So the initiative, which is now largely called Master Samman, but one of the implementation part is called Cloth for One, where communities pick up whole lot of development issues, that instead of money, they receive cloth, utensils, footwear and different kind of items as reward. Today, in some pictures, you will see that a large-scale work can happen without much money. Your old material can actually become a very big resource for the development in the country. That's why many studies which are happening on GOONJ's work right now, they call it the genesis of parallel economy, where you can actually do a lot without cash. Let me just show you some of the pictures of that. Am I wrong? This is Habib and his blind wife. In the last 20 years, the only thing which has changed in this rickshaw is just now he has this red horn and white, this thing. 20 years back, he never had this. This was that article, and he used to get 20 rupees and 2 meter of white cloth 20 years back, which became 50 rupees and 2 meter of white cloth. That was the only change which happened in almost 2 decades. This is how we work. So the most important part is that the sorting or the processing part, because as I said, that the biggest problem is that you give what you have, you never give what people need. So like, typically try to understand that if you talk about women clothing, what you collect from urban India is sari, blouse, say, you know, the ladies suit, jeans or t-shirt. What 99% of rural India need is sari, blouse, petticoat or the traditional dress. If you talk about urban male like me, waist size is 32 to 40. Rural male is 26 to 30. 30 to 40% of ladies' pajamas come without nada, without a sling. 30 to 40% of gents' trousers come with a non-working zip. That's the giving pattern. So we just take care of all that at the processing center. Then it goes to the villages. Communities are motivated not for any greed, not for any reward, but for self-respect. When we say that there are two ways of taking any material, because cloth is a need. One, when we give you and tomorrow we come and put our head on your shoulder and say that you are wearing my shirt, 100% villagers will say no, that I don't need it. Then we propose, and then there is a way that you work for your own village, not for GOONJ, not for the local partner group with whom we work. And then after doing any work, you receive this material. If I come tomorrow and say that you are wearing my shirt, you can immediately kick me out and you can tell me that it might be yours, but I have earned it. So I can sleep in a much better, much decent manner. That's the only motivational paragraph which we use across. And the result is that right from developing drainage system to repair of road to boundary walls, massive plantation drive, to a school in the Sitamani district of Bihar years back. Now they have a pakka proper school, but it was like 2007. We created this school. Every single person contributed, half or full bamboo, a bit of dry grass, a day of labor. Total expenditure of GOONJ on the spot was 80 rupees. Then to buy some steel wire. 2007 we had massive flood in Sitamani, but this structure was still intact because it was not created by a corporate or an NGO. It was created by people, and when you make it, you maintain it. That's the basic mantra, because that's your involvement. You saw this school in 2007. This school in the Kosi belt recently, 2009. Look at the entire change in design. Now they have different classes. They have a proper boundary wall that way, because now after every 2 feet they have put a tree. Within 2-3 years this tree will grow and we will only put a, you know, that katewala tar, that fencing, and it will become a boundary wall. So almost 150-200 kids actually go to this school. And there are many schools like this, totally created by the villagers with the village resources. Prakash Bhai is here from Khandwa. This is the story where no water for many years. Total dependency on a single hand pump, say about 400 meters you have to go down and take the water. When we spoke about it in December, some 7-8 people got together by December and January, the entire village was working. January 2009, we got the water. And when I say we, it is basically the local community. It's basically all the people there, not me, not Prakash Bhai from Khandwa, who will be talking to you later. The moment the water was there, they started putting pressure on the government and said that 60-70% of the work is already being done. Take it in a narega. It was taken in a narega and people were also paid wages. So just imagine that this is not about collecting of clothes and distributing it. It's about using something which is old, which is discarded, which is almost thrown away as a tool. As a tool for the local construction, as a tool for any kind of water work, any kind of development work, as a tool to mobilize community, as a tool to basically tell them that what kind of power you people have. A bridge, when we started in Bihar, in Madhepura district, a 240 feet by 6 feet bridge, take your pulsar and cross it, it is so sturdy. It put a lot of pressure on the government. Today, if you go to that particular village of Sukhasan, you have a pakka concrete bridge. Because the moment people take it in their own hand, government has no option but to move. Total cost to create this bridge out there was 2,250 rupees. Today we have a much larger bridge. In Odisha, it's about 700 feet. And in Assam. So there are about 8 such bridges in various parts of the country. Absolutely, almost at negligible cost. And the fact remains that these bridges are there for almost like 2 years, 3 years, and these are well maintained, because as I'm saying again, that when people make it, people maintain it. Some more exercises. I'm just trying to give you glimpses at what all can happen without spending money. The roads, the jungle. And this is across the country, because south, we, a lot of people said that people don't need clothes. But please also understand that clothing is not only related with the weather. Cloth is all about dignity. Cloth is basically a basic need. Odisha, massive work on this pond cleaning, because this is the major source of any kind of disease. As in the morning session you must have read, and even in the booklet it is written, that the major reason for the disease in India is the water. Ultimately, just 20 feet away from this pond, people will have a hand pump and will drink water of that hand pump and thinking that it's nice drinking water. But ultimately, this is the pond which is the source for that hand pump water also. But just because a little filtration happened and the water is coming out of that hand pump, you don't understand. So in Odisha, we have actually taken up massive exercises, which is now we are also doing in Assam and West Bengal, because these are 3-4 states where the total life depends on these neighboring ponds. To these different check dams in different part of the country. So that was one way of using old material. In the entire material, we also take out school material. We run many campaigns in schools, because schools also have a large scale or large number of underutilized material. And mostly this is plastic or paper. No urban school will ever tell you to reduce the usage, because that's the revenue model for them. So very simple fact. 150 worth of water bottle you discard because the string is not there. Bag you discard because the color is faded. Pencil box you discard because now He-Man is over, Pokemon is needed. Look at the reason, the way society is moving. Why can't we start imagining a plastic water bottle as a live thing and say that let the water bottle live and enjoy the urban life for 6 months, and then enjoy in village for 6 months, and then you recycle it for 6 rupees a kg. That's how the entire model works, because we all are too worried about education policy, curriculum, availability of teacher, building, everything. But the fact remains that in this country, even today, children leave school because they can't afford a water bottle when they go 3 kilometers walking. They leave schools because they cannot afford a recurring expense of notebook in a state like Uttarakhand and many, many other states. So we just take care of this material need. No donation, no charity. We are 100% against that when you put a table and banner and start distributing pencil box and all on 26 January to the kids, without understanding that at the age of 5, the senses of that child are not developed. Do not make that child dependent on charity or donation. Because if the next year that child does not get a pencil box from you, that child will think that his right is not being given to him. So we are actually distorting the entire system. In this thing, what we are trying to work, which is very tough, because this, you know, free donation is so ingrained in the system that no one wants to work on this. But what system we are evolving, that it is basically a reward program on 8 to 10 parameters, whether the kid comes on time or not, bachcha nahata hai ki nahi aata, time pe aata hai ki nahi aata, kitabe sahi se lagta hai ki nahi, all those very basic etiquette behavior kind of pattern, and then they are rewarded with this material. In few schools where it is implemented partially, it has very good results. So now it has a big scope to become a major reward exercise, and it will make sure that the attendance and everything is improved, because midday meal can only ensure attendance during lunch, not for the whole day. This is how urban kids participate. This is how another initiative with the toys, because Anganwadis are absolutely dry place. The kid is not attracted towards that, kid does not want to stay back. So what we do, we just make these places very colorful. Impact is, in the words of an Anganwadi worker who says, "Pehle bachcha aata nahi tha, bachcha jata nahi." So the basic purpose of the Anganwadi is to retain a kid at a decent place and then do whatever interventions you want. Just with 70 to 80 toys per Anganwadi, this is something which is happening hundreds of Anganwadis across the country. With old computers. This is the napkin part. I am not carrying this time the samples, but this is how we open up the subject in the communities. They are taught how to make it so that the practices improve. We stress on reuse, because use and throw can never change your habits, but this will change your habit. With the old cloth, last 2 years, 1.2 lakh of absolutely discarded cloth is a major income generation activities in many, many villages now, which are converted into this, which is called Sunni, Kudri, Kantha, Kantha. Every single state has a different name, but this is the major income generation activity, the last units of cloth. Some hearts in villages with the help of old materials. Old Dahej ki Dowry ki stitching machines and stitching centers at various places. Some of the recognitions to GOONJ. This is how people participate. And this is my last slide. We call him community. In the development sector, in the corporate and all, we call him community. When you see this child, you actually have all the negative words. Aapko lagta hai ki wo bechara hai, nanga hai, bhuka hai, lachar hai. My question is that why can't your community look like this? When you put a drop, two drops of polio in the mouth of that child, you don't question ki ye bachcha nanga kyun hai, why this kid is naked. Usi ko midday meal bhi khilate hain, usko school mein bhi padhate hain. Wo same bachcha, the only difference is a pair of cloth. So why can't our community look like this? If you go to a village, you will not go to this person. But if your community looks like this, is there any harm? And this is the last recent photograph of Odisha. This is one person for whom all of us try to work. And the only difference is a pair of cloth. Thank you very much.